Who? Hallelujah.
Because love. Because love.
Just fall on him and give him.
Last week
at the Valentine's concert, there was too much kissing going on, and he got real offended. So, well, there'll be none of that. No touchy-feely.
Yes.
feely, no kissy wissy.
That broadcast is not for the Pharisees. It's only for the real Christian people. Yeah.
And you know, we got some awesome people following us, and I just wanted you know, invite somebody in. You know, if you believe that we're doing a good work here, I really want you to just invite people in and to share what all this research and truth that we're speaking, because trust me, it is the word of the Lord. It is Jesus Christ. It's His word, okay? And it will not return to it void. Okay, He will accomplish what it's set out to do. Right, will not return to Him void. So my thing is that we're out there and we're taking risks a lot of times because it's difficult sometimes to talk about some subjects that are hard. It's very hard. My friends are going to like
it. Well, I think this is going to be fun today.
Really?
I don't know what I consider fun.
Well, we all know what fun is to Veronica.
I think this is going to be fun. Oh, yeah, really.
It's going to be exciting.
Yeah, what's fun for me is maybe boring for other people. But anyway.
No, it's not boring. So, it's just scary. It's frightening. Bishop is all, you know, Bishop Lowe goes in the other room when we start to preach.
Oh, okay. Oh, no. I don't think so. Well, let me just start out by saying I think that we both can agree that there has never been so much deception in this world, so much deception and lies in the world as there is right now.
Yeah, well, I'll give an example. I was just watching some music this week, and two singers that I know, personally, uh-huh. They're wearing dresses. And I'm saying, maybe I should get a dress. What do you think, guys? What do you think? It had to be more like a tent.
I don't think. I know you're hoping ponchos come back in style.
Ponchos. I really have a problem.
Which they are, actually.
No, but I do have a problem with guys wearing dresses, people.
Absolutely.
No, I'm just being honest. Absolutely. I mean, I'm like, wait a minute. Are you trying to be cool? Are you trying to fit in? Or are you just trying to be like your wife or your girlfriend? Well, you know, that ain't gonna fly.
I think, you know, the whole music industry is pushing, and we learned from the death of Prince that we learned that the whole agenda of androgyny was being pushed in the media, after his death. We heard that word 100 times during that whole media saga of his death. So we know that androgyny is being pushed in the media big time.
I have a coin phrase. Uh-huh. Sin is in.
That's right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Would everybody agree with that? Sin is in?
That's because of deception, that's what that leads to. Deception leads to sin. Mm. And so because of this deception and this false doctrine that has crept into the Christian church, okay, that's what you're talking about.
Correct.
The result
Correct.
Is people being put back into bondage, okay, into the slavery of sin, rather than being made free. And so that's what we're trying to accomplish through Loving You to the Truth with Angelo Veronica.
Yeah, we want to help people.
Wanting to make people free through God's
Absolutely.
Word, okay?
But so you know, today, my honey also was challenging them. My Freemasonry.
Don't. All right, so today we're exposing false sayings or half-truths, okay, most used in the church and among Christians. Guys, these are things that we have been guilty of saying as well, okay? But these are false sayings, half-truths that are used in the church and among Christians, including ourselves, that are unbiblical and unsound. And we're going to discuss exactly why that is. So some of these sayings, and I just want you guys to brace yourselves, because some of these sayings are from popular preachers, okay? Popular singers, all right? Including ourselves, all right? So we're in this bunch, okay?
We are, really?
And yes, we are. Yes, we are. But, guys, we seek to shed light on the truth and expose darkness, and we are Guys, we are students of the Word of God, and I search the Word every single day because I want to dispel each and every lie, okay,
right,
that comes at me and that I've ever believed in
sure.
my life, okay? That's what makes me free. That's what makes me happy. So that's what I do. Guys, I don't know about you, but we are sick of lies and deception. Even our president has talked about this fake news and the lies in the media, okay? So the devil is the best liar in the world.
Oh, he's good.
He is so good.
Oh,
because you know why?
Man. He doesn't just sleep. He lies to us in our sleep.
Yeah.
He's real good.
Yeah. He's the best liar because he speaks in half truths.
Sure.
He'll give you some truth.
Yeah.
Okay? But he's gonna sprinkle some lies in there, okay? So there's no such thing as white lies. All right, they're all demonic.
Being racist.
Okay.
Not lies.
What? So lies bring you into bondage, guys. They bring you into slavery, okay? Lies bring bondage and captivity, but truth brings freedom. Now, one of the things that we have observed in the church, okay, is that, and I hate to single out the African American church, and that's only because we've sang at predominantly black churches most of our ministry.
Well, after we got booed at the white church, we have to find some place to go.
That's right. Well, and not just the black church, but a lot of churches use certain phrases and music in order to trigger emotion to create an emotional frenzy.
Say that one more time.
Okay?
I want you to go back
certain
there.
Churches, you know, not all, but churches use certain phrases and music, certain chords, certain music to trigger emotion, to create frenzy, okay? And let me tell you guys, when you are out of control, when there's a frenzy, okay, in church, all right, it's not always of the Holy Spirit. I am sorry to tell you. And let me tell you, when you are out of control, you cannot think rationally. So that is the point that we want to make. The Bible says, I believe it's in Isaiah, the Lord says, come, let us reason together. So God wants us to think rationally. He wants us to use critical thinking. And that's sometimes in the church, we don't use that. We end up doing things, we don't know why we're doing it.
Well, there's a word.
And we should never be in that predicament.
Well, there's one word that really disturbs me when I hear this. In church, particularly, they go, why don't we just travail? Travail? When I wasn't saved, if somebody said, let's travail, I'd be like, what? What are you saying? What language is that? Is that like the religious language of the day? Caiaphas and all his buddies?
Oh my God.
I mean, what kind of foolishness is that? You know what I'm saying? You know, you be led and be moved by the Spirit of God. If that moves you, fine. But when you purposefully start into this holy religious thing that just leads people into going to sleep or trance almost, It's
wow.
Very subliminal.
Again, not using your mind and
not discerning spirits.
Right. And not researching things in the Word, seeing if they're of God, okay? Not testing the spirits, not looking in the Bible to see if things are of God. So 2 Timothy 4:3, this is sort of the scripture that this is based around today. 2 Timothy 4:3 and 4. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, our own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. Okay, now that would be false teachers. And they will turn their ear, the congregation will turn their ear away from the truth and be turned aside to fables.
Wow.
Okay, so guys, we're in that time. We are right now, 2017, we are in that time where people are not enduring sound doctrine. They don't know what the Bible says. I'm amazed that people call themselves Christians and they have no idea how God feels about certain subjects. So it's just frightening.
Well, to me, it's like when I talk to people here in Tennessee, everybody's a Christian.
Yes.
And my thing is,
I don't understand. That's not even a popular thing to be. So I don't understand that.
After I talk to them about 10 minutes or so, they look at me strangely. And I look at them and I go, have you not read?
Amen.
Because Jesus is going to say to you, have you not read, people, my word?
That's right.
You know, so we have no excuse.
Nobody enters into an agreement or a contract without reading it.
Right.
I mean, if you do, then you're very foolish for doing that. So guys, you're entering into a covenant with God, an eternal covenant. Okay, so no, the covenant is the word of God. All right, this is an agreement that you're making with God. So know what you're
signing up for.
Yes, uh-huh. Exactly. All right. So number one for me. So again, this is popular Christian sayings debunked or exposed. All right. So these are the most popular church sayings. I found 9 of them, so I hope we can get through them all. And so this is by far number one to me. This is by far my probably one of my biggest pet peeves, okay, in terms of Christian or church sayings. Number one, God moves in mysterious ways.
My Lord Jesus, help me. Yeah, he's mysterious. His Bible's mysterious. You know what? The Bible's a mystery. It's not fact. It's a mystery. It's mystical.
So, well, Colossians 1:26 says, the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to his saints.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay? So to them, God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So I understand how people would think God moves in mysterious ways, because right here it's saying that you have to be a saint of God to know his mystery, you know, and you have to know Christ in order to know this God's mysterious ways.
The Bible's not mystical.
Absolutely not.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely
Sorry.
Not. So God doesn't hide things from us. Now, yes, we've got to search the word, and that's what he wants. You know, there's a scripture, if I can remember it now. But let me go on to this, and I might remember. Ephesians 1:9, having made known to us the mystery of his will. Guys, God's will is not a mystery, all right? God does not move in mysterious ways as far as his will. He's made it known to us. It's called the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
It's called the Bible. Again, you cannot know his will if you do not learn the Word. You cannot know his will if you do not learn the word of God. So you don't know, have to be sitting around and wondering, oh, what's God's will? God, what's God's will?
Yeah, yeah.
Get into the Bible. Get into his word. His word is his will.
Well, again, in the weeks to come, we're going to be talking about the word as it pertains to tithes and offerings. And we're gonna dispel a lot of theory.
I hope we can. Yes.
It's about opening your eyes to the truth. Please, people, we're not here to hurt or put somebody down. We're here to expose the work of darkness.
Yes,
reveal the light, so that you can see clearly and you make rational decisions in your life. without people controlling and manipulating your life. Yes. Spiritually, I'm talking about.
Because that's the thing. If you don't learn the Word of God, then somebody is going to end up controlling your life.
Correct.
And that's...
Correct.
And it won't be of God. It won't be of God. Yep. That's the one of the many dangers.
And that's
not knowing the word.
That's the ones that move in mysterious ways.
The massacre at Jim Jones happened. You know, those people drank the Kool-Aid, so to speak.
But those are the ones who are moving in mysterious ways. The guys that
you understand what I'm saying.
But what I'm saying is they're the ones that move in mysterious ways. Not Jesus.
Yes, yeah, because they don't know the word.
Exactly.
Romans 16, 25, 20 to 26. Now to him who is able to establish you according to my gospel. Paul is saying my gospel. I mean, he holds it, you know, so dear. He's saying my gospel. And the preaching of Jesus Christ, which is what he preached, according to the revelation of the mystery kept secret since the world began, but now made manifest. Guys, the mystery of God has now been made manifest. It was kept secret, but now is made manifest. How? By the prophetic scriptures made known to all nations. Guys, this is for all nations, people of any and every race, every country in the world, every nation, this has been made known to. Okay, and it is made known through prophetic scriptures. So we do not have to be in the dark. God does not have to move in mysterious ways in our lives. Mark 4:11, Jesus said to them, "To you it has been given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. But to those who are outside, all things come in parables." Okay, so to his disciples, if you are a follower of Christ,
right.
Okay, if you are a disciple of Jesus, and again, you can search the word to really understand what that means. Things don't have to be a mystery. Things don't have to be a mystery. So that's my number one, I think it's a false Christian saying.
You know, Veronica, I can almost accept that from a new Christian who might say that. Not knowing the Bible.
Yeah.
But when I hear a gospel singer say that, you have to watch and listen for the signs. What comes out of your favorite gospel singer's mouth, you better listen to what they're saying. You better find out. You know, I tell churches, I go, you know, we're so moved by the record industry and by success in they're number one on the... I know this one artist. Oh, I'm number four on the charts. Just right. What number are you? Well, I'm not any number. But see, what happens is the church brings these people in thinking that they're going to bring in something anointed to bring to their congregation. And what they wind up bringing is something annoying. And then they spend the next 6 years trying to clean up the mess of the person that they brought in to...
Yeah, the days are over we looked up to singers, preachers, entertainers, sports figures. Guys, those days are over.
That's right.
Okay? Christ did not say follow men. Mm-mm. Christ said follow me. Mm. Okay? We are supposed to follow Christ and not follow men.
You know,
that's us into so much trouble.
And I want to say this. Years ago, a man spoke to me. I was actually giving a testimony at a conference. And I'm standing up front, and all of a sudden, and all these so-called big pastors were sitting behind me, but I didn't care. I just, you know, I had 15 minutes, and I was going to sing. I was going to give a testimony and sing a song. Well, I was giving the testimony. As I was giving the testimony, a guy comes walking across the stage, and I wish I had that note. But he hands me a note, and it said, "Shut up, just sing." That's exactly what it said. "Shut up, just sing." And I turned around. And I looked at these mean faces behind me. I'm like, I'm saying to myself, what am I doing here? What am I doing here? This is not of God. This is not the Lord. And I wasn't overstepping my time. I was being very conscientious of what I was specifically trying
time,
to...
Time, yeah.
Right.
Time, yeah.
And so. But what happens is that stood with me.
Yeah.
What he spoke over me. See, that's what I'm telling you people.
Find that in Jesus'
name. Words are powerful.
Right.
Be careful who lays hands on you. Don't let anybody lay hands on you. Be careful who speaks to, over you, who speaks into your life. Be very, very careful, yeah, because those seeds may sprout up in a time where you need to rise up. And what happens is you get so intimidated by it, you shut up. Okay?
And that's what the enemy wants to do. Guys,
know what I'm saying? I'm saying it's great that we do music. Yeah. And a lot of people come on just to hear us sing. But I'm telling you right now, there's a season in Angelo Veronica's life where God is showing us and exposing stuff to us to share with you that you need to know. No, not just about singing and dancing. You need to hear what the word of the Lord is saying in our ministry.
If the word of the Lord is in your mouth, the word of God is in your mouth, guys, speak it.
Yep.
No matter who says to shut up.
That's right.
Speak it. Do not stay silent
with
your testimony and with the word of God.
They're just men.
Do not stay silent.
They're mere men.
All right, number two. Popular Christian sayings debunked. All right, and I have used this one.
Sure,
the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come, I believe, is a half truth, okay? And it's something that just the Lord, you know, just kind of showed me one day. So eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Guys, this promise is for those who love him. Guys, if you love God, you will obey God. All right? So the best is not to come for everyone. So Proverbs 4:18, but the path of the just or the righteous is like the shining sun that shines ever brighter unto the perfect day. Okay, so when they say your best days are yet to come, guys, this is a promise that is for the righteous and those who love him.
Is it for the biggest tither?
So, nope.
No?
For the righteous, for those who love him, and for the just and the righteous. Bye, honey. All right, number three. And I have used this as well, and I never, ever will again. Number three.
We should be honest.
This too shall pass.
Oh.
Is not
is that
in
George
the
Harrison's
Bible.
Song?
This too shall pass, guys. Not in the Bible. It's not
is that
in the
a Beatles
Bible.
Song?
So.
This too shall pass?
I don't know.
Yeah, something like that.
Really?
Yeah.
2 Corinthians 4:17-18. I think this is what this saying is based on, okay? For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So I think that's where that comes from. You know what? The things that are, for the things which are seen are temporary.
Yeah, and I just want the folks out there to know that I've never said any of these sayings. You know, some people who
we're not done yet.
Oh.
We're not done yet. Yeah.
You have some of my quotes
there? We're not done yet. All right. Number four. Spare the rod, spoil the child. Okay? That's not exactly correct. Proverbs 13:24 says, he who spares his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him promptly. So spare the rod. It's beyond spoiling your child. You hate your child. That's what the Bible is saying.
Wow.
So that's how
important. I said that.
Okay. So all right, there you go.
Yeah,
there you go. So all right, number five. Christian sayings debunked. God helps those who help themselves.
Oh, my.
God helps those who help themselves. Yeah. Somebody just sent that to me in an email.
That's a beautiful thing. God helps those who help themselves.
Yes. All right. Well, this is from Got Questions, and I love this.
That's a good one.
God helps those who help themselves is probably the most often quoted phrase that is not found in the Bible. This saying, is usually attributed to Benjamin Franklin. All right? And Benjamin Franklin was not a Christian man. He was a Freemason, and he was an occultist.
Why are you picking on Freemasons, Veronica?
So people need to know. People need to know that he doubted the divinity of Christ, of God. He quoted this in Poor Richard's Almanac in 1757. In actuality, it originated from Algernon Sidney in 1698 in an article called Discourses Concerning Government. Okay, so it's one of those sources. So whatever the source is, the Bible teaches the opposite.
Sorcery. Yeah.
Yeah.
There you go.
God, in fact, helps the helpless. That's the type of God we serve.
Isaiah 25:4 God helps you if you give enough money.
Oh, wow.
You have to give money to get something from God. What's wrong with you? What kind of God do you serve?
Wow, right. For you have been a defense for the helpless, a defense for the needy in his distress, a refuge from the storm, a shade from heat. Romans 5:6 tells us, for while we were still helpless, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. So God, does not, if you can help yourself, why do you need God?
Exactly.
Right? So God helps those who cannot help themselves. So that is, that's awesome. Who cannot help themselves.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's know that they're
helpless. That's why we have a savior.
Know that they're helpless, right? And they need to be saved, and they're
I need a savior.
Needy, yes, yes.
I don't know about you.
Needy coming to God, which is awesome. All right. Okay. This is a big one. This is a big one. And I actually love this saying. I actually love it, but it is not 100% biblical.
Okay.
So that's what we're talking about.
Let's
all right.
Lay it on.
All right. Yes. Number 6. God hates the sin, but loves the sinner.
Oh my.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so
kind. I love it.
It's very common.
I love that saying.
Oh, it's very tolerant.
I love that saying, but it's
very
not,
tolerant.
It's not exactly what the Bible says. Psalm 11:5 says, the Lord tests the righteous, but the wicked and the one who loves violence, his soul hates.
Oh, there you go. The numbers just went down from 100 to 5. Okay, so that's because of your message here. I mean, these folks have been quoting these scriptures for, these non-scriptures.
Yeah.
I mean, these foolish phrases.
Psalm 5:5 says, the boastful shall not stand in your sight. You hate all workers of iniquity.
Iniquity, right.
So God expresses hatred for those who love violence.
Yeah.
He expresses hatred for workers of iniquity.
Sure.
But guess what? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son.
And you know what?
He showed his ultimate love through the sacrifice of his son.
Yeah, and he didn't come to be served, but served his life as a ransom for many.
Yeah.
I mean, God was the ultimate servant.
So you see how, we love these sayings, but
love the Bible sayings. Just,
That's right.
Repeat
love
what Jesus said.
Right.
Repent or likewise perish. That's one of my favorites.
That's right. We try to make it easy and witty and cutesy, and you know what? Just learn the word of God. Just memorize
God's word. You're ruining my whole thing, because I had a book for years. It was pastoral phrases. Things that pastors say that have no biblical sense whatsoever.
Oh, well, here's another
one. Give me another one.
Here is another one. Oh gosh, another saying that I've used and you've used.
No, I haven't.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And it sounds so good. All right, number 7. Go where you're celebrated, not
tolerated. I've used that quite often. I think I said it to you last week.
Go where you're celebrated, not. Guys, these sayings sound so good.
No,
they tickle our ears.
They tickle our ears.
It's what we want to hear.
It sounds good.
Yeah, it sounds good.
Yeah.
It sounds good.
just it makes no biblical sense.
But this is absolutely not biblical.
It's nonsense.
For a Christian, and I'll tell you why. Luke 6:26, Jesus said, "Woe to you when all men speak well of you." Woe to you when all men speak well of you. Does that sound like a celebration?
Honey.
Of you?
If you want to celebrate something, if you want to feel celebrated,
if all men are celebrating you, something is actually wrong.
But think about this. God himself said, "You are fearfully and wonderfully made in my image." How much more celebration do you need?
Oh, hold on. Okay. Yes. The Bible says, "For they love the praise of men more than the praise of God," which means God can praise us. God celebrates us. God does. God praises us, and God celebrates us.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what he doesn't do. I'll tell you what he doesn't do. He doesn't tolerate us. He celebrates us, but he doesn't tolerate us.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't tolerate our sin.
Yeah, amen, amen. John 15:18, and these are all quotes from Jesus. "If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you, love its own.
Yeah.
Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you."
Correct.
Okay, so guys, if this world celebrates you, all right, then chances are God is probably not celebrating you, all right? Because if you are of the world would love you or celebrate you, okay, as its own. So we have to look to, all right, for God to celebrate us, for God to praise us. We have to look and search for the approval of God and God only. Mark 13:13 says, "You will be hated by all." Why? "For my name's sake," for Jesus' sake, we will be hated. Bottom line, this is what Jesus said, "But he who endures to the end shall be saved."
Wow.
Okay? So do not look for man to celebrate you, all right? It says you will be hated by all. What are you going to do? Are you going to choose the love of man or the love of God? That's the big question.
There you go.
Because Jesus is saying you're going to be hated by all because you are a Christian and because you follow me. Matthew 5:11, "Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven." So what do we get for all this hatred from the world? We get blessed. We get our reward in heaven. All right? The two most important things, spiritual blessings and an eternal life.
Amen.
Eternal life in Christ.
Sure.
In God,
mm-hmm.
you know, so we gain much more when we, sacrifice our reputations, so to speak, you know, in order to follow Christ. So
this is a very important lesson. Well, I want to say this.
It's been hard for us to learn.
Yeah, but I'm going to say this. We haven't been celebrated, okay, the way some of these preachers have told us we'd be celebrated, because we stopped the word tolerating. Because we realize that tolerating only promotes more sin. Because then you're just talking about accepting somebody's sin. And the world calls it being tolerant so that they can just speak whatever they want and do whatever you want, and it'll be okay you'll get over your sin, don't worry about it. Well, you know what? You may die in the next 30 seconds. You don't have time to tolerate your sin.
Yeah.
You just don't have time, people.
Yes.
We don't.
Yes. That's the danger in celebrating people is just looking beyond all their faults and all their sins and not, you know, letting them know, hey, brother, you know what I'm saying? maybe you need to get right with the Lord, you know, which could save their soul. Number eight, and this is actually a quote that I've seen in social media, actually by a Christian singer. And it's just, I don't know, I mean, I liked it at first, but then I was like, you know what, that's really not right, you know? So anyway, I put that part of this, and it is number eight for me. Knowing, and it says, it's very clever, knowing the Bible is one thing, knowing the author is another. And that could be true in the case of, there are secular atheist Bible historians that learn the Word of God, but yet don't believe it. They don't believe in the author. They don't believe in Jesus. They don't believe in God. So I can understand, but most of us are not Bible historians, okay? So knowing the Bible is one thing, knowing the author is another. But in order to know, but Jesus said, I am the Word of God made flesh, you know? So knowing God's Word is knowing the Lord, knowing Jesus. Knowing Jesus is knowing God's Word. So you really cannot separate the two. And that's why, to me, this phrase de-emphasizes and belittles the importance of learning God's Word. What do you think?
Well, that's basically what church is for. Church is so that you don't have to read the Bible. Because I had a friend of mine tell me, I'm just telling you what he told me. He said, look, I said, why are you going back to this church, brother? You know what they're about? And I was exposing some works of darkness. And he goes, well, I go there to hear the word of the Lord. And I'm like, okay.
Wow.
Well, why don't you just stay home.
It's your job.
Stay home with your wife and you open up the Bible and you read the Bible together and discuss the Bible.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you'll get some revelation that you didn't get before because you yourself is applying the actual effort into reading the Word of God. God wants you to read His Word. He wants you to study His Word. Study to show yourself approved. Okay, so, you know, don't rely on the church or a pastor to be your spiritual walk with God. What's the point of having a savior? Why do you need a savior if you go to church? Your pastor is now your savior. You know what? Angelo and Veronica are not your saviors.
Don't follow men. Yes.
We are just messengers of the Word of God. That's it. We're not your savior. Go after Jesus. Go after His Word. Be passionate about being vigilant. About His Word.
Yes. Now, I cannot emphasize these scriptures more. 1 John 1:1 and John 1:14. So please open your other devices or your Bible and read along, because John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Guys, the Word is God. The Word is God.
Mm-hmm.
John 1:14 says, and the Word became flesh, that's Jesus, and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Okay, so the Word of God became flesh, and it was Jesus.
Yeah.
The Word of God actually was formed as a man, and that person is Jesus. So guys, Jesus is the Word. God is the Word. So you cannot separate the two.
Yeah, but if you don't know the Lord, if you don't know the Bible, that's really a hard pill to swallow. And see, that's what faith is, people. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. See, and I had a guy tell me, don't tell me that faith...
No, it's too late to learn to open up your Bible.
An atheist told me that, don't tell me about that you're going to base your spiritual walk with Jesus based on faith? I'm like, absolutely I am. Because without faith, I can't please God.
That's right, yes.
So yes, I have to have this faith to believe in something I can't see. You know, and it's like we do it Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. We worship the Lord, we sing songs of praise, and we look to our left or we look to our right, and if there's a black guy next to us, we don't like him. If there's a white guy next to us, we don't like him. Because we're so cultural that we're not even, we've lost the spirituality because of all the divisiveness.
And you know, if people want historical evidence, it's out there.
Oh, yeah.
If people want scientific evidence, it's there. It's all there. You know what I'm saying? But yes, Christianity is the basis of Christianity is faith in Jesus.
How many people saw?
You can't get around that.
Saw the tomb with 500, over 500 people saw Jesus.
That's right. Yes.
Right.
Yes. After Jesus resurrected, over 500 believers and non-believers, I believe it's 1 Corinthians 15, saw Jesus after he resurrected. And there are secular historians that testify to Jesus living, Jesus being crucified, and that the disciples, in fact, witnessed a resurrected Christ.
Right, and the fact that...
talking about secular historians.
And here it is, guys. Here it is in a nutshell. Why would you take a chance on your soul? We're all going to die, right? We're all going to pass this world. But you make a choice on where you want to go. You make a decision. You know, you have that choice and you have a decision to make. You know what? Don't gamble your soul away. Don't, you know, roll the dice. Well, you know what? Maybe what they're saying is true. Maybe it's not true. Well, you know what? There's more evidence that we are preaching the truth and that Jesus is who he said he is more than he's not. And you know what? And I'm not going to risk my soul and my life based upon that information. And I got 2,000 years of information, okay, in his word.
That's right. The Bible is historically backed up. It's scientifically backed up.
It's still the number one book in the world. Not Joel Osteen's.
Yeah, amen.
Jesus Christ's word.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
Read his word, not anybody else's.
That's right. All right, number 9, and this is the last one. Popular Christian sayings debunked. And this is probably one of the most popular Christian sayings that I have used, you have used. Oh my gosh.
In business, be men?
No.
Wisdom makes knowledge. Wisdom makes knowledge acceptable.
Okay, well, debunk it.
Is debunked.
Oh.
It's not in the word. it's out of a sorcerer's mouth.
Oh,
okay, go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, number 9. I plead the blood.
Pleading.
I plead the blood, and I was not going to do this one.
I know.
Was not going to do this one.
Pastor Chris was absolutely right.
I absolutely had to. Now, this is from Got Questions. And this website says, pleading the blood of Jesus has no clear basis in Scripture. No one in the Bible ever pleads the blood of Christ. Those who plead the blood often do so as if there were something magical in those words, or as if by using them, prayer is somehow more powerful. This teaching is born from a misguided view of prayer, that prayer is a way of manipulating God to get what we want rather than praying for his will to be done. The whole, I hate to say, Word of Faith movement, which teaches pleading the blood, is founded on the false teaching that faith is a force, and that if we pray with enough faith, God guarantees us health, wealth, and happiness. Those who teach the value of pleading the blood of Jesus usually point to the Passover as support of their practice, which mm-hmm. I can understand. It is quite common for Pentecostalism to base its doctrines on Old Testament examples. Just as the blood of the Paschal Lamb protected the Israelites from the angel of death and led to their deliverance from slavery, so the blood of Jesus can protect and deliver Christians today if they apply or plead it. Do the words, "I plead the blood of Jesus," give our prayers an extra kick? Guys, ask yourselves that according to God's words. This website says no. That's more superstition than biblical prayer. And I have to agree. Pleading the blood of Christ is not needed to defeat Satan. He has already been defeated, and if we are born again, Satan has no power over us other than what God allows for his purpose and glory. No need to continually plead the blood.
Right.
I mean, you know, and this is my commentary. The primary purpose of the blood of Jesus is to cleanse us from our sins. That is the primary purpose. That is why Christ was crucified, to make atonement for our sins. 1 John 1:7 says, "The blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin." Okay? When our sins are washed away, then and only then do we have supernatural protection because of the blood of Jesus. So the blood of Jesus does protect us.
Sure.
You know? But it is of no use to confess or plead the blood of Jesus, which again, nobody has ever done in the Bible. Okay? But the Bible says we are to confess our sins. Mm-hmm. We are to confess Jesus as Lord, and we are to confess Christ before men. So these are the things that need to come out of our mouth and the Word of God. You know,
sure.
These are the things that we need to speak. So there is no pleading. There is no begging. There is no getting on our knees and trying to get something from God that he has already given us.
Sure.
You know, we just agree with his word. That's all we have to do, you know. And
what happens is we're so churchified people, and that, you know, not to beat up on pastors, you know, because, you know, but a lot of the pastors, God has shown me clearly that it's almost like we're going to a nightclub rather than church. And it's like, I remember back in the day, it was like they had a big thing called ladies' night, where the ladies would come in free, whatever. Well, I'm like, church is ladies' night every night. I mean, these pastors, man, they got it made, dude. It's ladies' night.
That's
ain't nothing
right,
but it's 85% ladies,
right.
And there's another 5 to 10 of men, and 5 of those want to be ladies. So you got, it's crazy. You know, and not every church is this way, people. There are great houses of the Lord. There are many, many men of God. But I'll tell you what, I love this, what you said to me, Veronica.
Yeah.
I was sharing with my wife about church members, membership, and that, it's important to have church members, you know. Well, for who? Okay, first of all, and for what purpose? Okay, so I said, numbers are very important. And she says, not to God, they're not.
Yeah.
And I said, sure they are. She goes, no, they're not. The Bible says that many are called, but few
that are chosen.
That are chosen.
Yeah.
So the numbers mean nothing. In other words, the few is more powerful than the many.
The wide is the path that leads to destruction,
mm-hmm.
which the many are on. And straight and narrow is the path that leads to life, which the few are on. Now, everybody is important to God. God desires that no one should perish, but that all should be saved. But really, my goodness, in the end, what's going to be important to God is the few. You know what I'm saying? Because many are on that wide path. You know? So when people say, oh, numbers are important to God, I'm like, well, you know, yeah, the few. That's what's important to God. And so you guys watching are important to God. Know that the Lord has not forgotten about you. He hasn't forgotten about your situation and the trials that you're going through. Just like we sang, God knows today. God knows. He already knows. He already has that foreknowledge. And that's why he's given us his word. Because let me tell you, it will prepare you, okay, for what is to come. All right? That's what part of what the word of God does. All right? And 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Guys, this is what the blood of Jesus is for, to cleanse us from our sins. And you can do that today, no matter where you are. You can confess your sins to God. All right? If you feel the conviction of the Lord, that's a good thing. If you feel sorry, if you feel a little sad about your sins, that's a good thing, okay? Because godly sorrow leads to salvation, all right? So there is a certain godly sorrow that we should have, okay? If we are practicing sin in our lives, all right? So, but guys, here's the remedy. Here is the remedy. Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. God, it is so important to confess the Lord. Speak it out of your mouth. That's how demons tremble, okay? That's how demons will become afraid. That's how demons will go from your life. This is how evil spirits go from your life, okay? You start speaking that Jesus is Lord, okay? And start doing these things, all right, that are in the Bible, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, and that means that you believe he is who he says he is, all right? That you believe that he is the Messiah and that he is the Savior and that he is the one true God, all right? And then Luke 2:8, it says, Jesus said, also I say to you, whoever confesses me before men, him the Son of Man also will confess before the angels of God. Guys, if you want God, all right? If you want Jesus to confess you before the angels of God, then confess Jesus. Confess Jesus. Confess Jesus as Lord, okay? And tell others about Christ, all right? If you want to be celebrated by God, tell others about Christ. All right? If you want the praise of God, tell others about Jesus. Okay? If you confess him before men, he will confess you before God and before the angels of God. So that is so exciting. Hallelujah. Do you want to pray with them? Pray with them? Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Father, we just praise you. We thank you for those who are out there today who have ears to hear, who have tuned in and really want to just dig deeper in God's word and your word, Lord. And we just thank you for them. I thank you for the lost souls. I thank you for the atheists. I thank you for those who are walking in sin and practicing sin. And Father God, I ask, Father God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you deliver them today, that you give them freedom, because they can be free from themselves. They can be free from the devil's trappings. And Father God, I just lift them up to you right now, Heavenly Father. And I ask for your delivering power to work in the lives of those who are being deceived and trapped and thinking that they have to live a certain lifestyle to be accepted, or they have to be a certain way to be accepted. Father God, you have told them that they are fearfully and wonderfully made in your image. And Father God, that they don't have to be anybody but who you created them to be. And Father God, I just thank you, Lord, that these phrases that people hear, that the Father begin to bring clarity to that this is just fancy, foolishness, that we talk these crazy things out of our mouths. And Father God, it's not your word. And Father God, I want to speak your word. I want to be in your word and live your word out, because it's the word of God that changes lives. We don't change nobody. It's the word of God that changes.
Yes.
So I pray for your change today. I pray for your commitment today. I pray for your submitting to God today for your life and your soul.
Amen. The Bible says, submit to God. Resist the devil and he must flee. So guys, if you can just repeat these words. Lord Jesus, I submit to you today.
I submit to you
today. I resist the devil.
And he must flee from my life. From my life.
I confess you as Lord.
As Lord.
I believe in my heart that you were raised from the dead.
And today.
I repent of my sins.
Of all my sins.
And I am saved. And I thank you, God, for eternal life. Starting today.
Through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
We'll take you to a higher place, God. Hallelujah. Take you to a higher place.
Oh, but you take me to